If you're even somewhat familiar with data compression, you've probably heard of Huffman coding. This is one of the ways your JPEGs, PNGs, MP3s, and zip files compress data without losing information. But even though Huffman coding is so ubiquitous, we've known a better algorithm since the 70s, arithmetic coding, which uses arithmetic to turn data into a single number. The JPEG specification actually supports arithmetic coding, but if you try to open an arithmetic-coded JPEG, depending on the application, you might get an error. The reason for this is that arithmetic coding was historically covered by patents. Even though those patents have all long expired, nobody wants to implement support for something nobody uses, and nobody wants to use something nobody supports. There's also a newer family of compression algorithms called asymmetric numeral systems. The inventor of ANS put it in the public domain, but both Google and Microsoft tried to patent it, and Microsoft eventually succeeded by telling the government, "We disagree with your rejection." In this video, I want to build these two algorithms from the ground up. They're both super compact, clever algorithms that store data in a single number, and I think it's a shame that patents might discourage their use. But first, let's look at Huffman coding and see why it's not optimal. You use it when you want to turn a message, a sequence of characters or symbols, into a sequence of binary digits or bits. Now, I'm using letters here, but these symbols can be any data. You provide a list of all the possible symbols with their probabilities. So, for example, the probability that a symbol in the message is an I is 1/5. You expect about a fifth of the symbols in the message to be an I. Then the Huffman algorithm assigns to each symbol a binary symbol code, and you encode the data by just replacing the symbols with their codes. To decode, you match the leftmost part of the encoded data to a symbol code and discard the bits. Huffman coding is the best algorithm for symbol codes, code systems where each symbol has a separate code, because it assigns shorter codes to more frequent symbols. If you want to learn more, Reducible has a nice video about why it works. If the frequencies of the symbols in the message match the given probabilities, the Huffman encoding will be as short as possible. But that's only for a symbol code, where each bit contains information for just one symbol. If we let bits encode multiple symbols, we can do better. Take the set of 10 symbols 0 through 9. If they all have the same probability, this is a code Huffman's algorithm gives us. Encoding this sequence of symbols gets us 68 bits. But there's a really simple way to do even better. Imagine this message itself as one big number. If you simply convert this number from base 10 to base 2, you get 64 bits, fewer than Huffman. Somehow this code carries the same information with fewer bits. This raises a natural question. What algorithm gives us the smallest possible average code length for a message? Here, average code length has a concrete definition. For a given coding system, the average code length is the expected value of code length, the sum of the code length for each message, weighted by the probability of seeing that message. Now, this doesn't make sense with infinite messages, so we'll just consider messages that are n symbols long, and see what happens as n approaches infinity. And like before, we'll assume that the symbols of our message have set probability distributions, and that they're all randomly sampled independently from each other. So pi is the probability that a symbol is si. This is called a discrete memoryless source, and each symbol is an independent and identically distributed random variable. You might wonder if these assumptions are even valid, and in fact, it is true that these probabilistic compression methods don't perform well on data that doesn't match the probability model, which is why you usually transform the data beforehand to make it look more like a DMS. But anyway, the key pattern here is that as n grows, the proportions of the symbols that make up a random message will look more and more like the predefined probabilities. For any symbol si, there will be about n times pi of that symbol in a message. A message that looks like this is called typical, and as n approaches infinity, the probability that a random message is typical approaches 1. Sort of. The real proof is more rigorous. You can look up asymptotic equipartition property and strong typicality if you want to learn more. But the basic idea is that we can now just find the minimum average code length of a typical message instead of any message, to at least get a lower bound on average code length. This is nice because you have the same probability of seeing any typical message, so the expected code length is just the average code length. Because the symbols are independent, the probability of a message is just the product of the probabilities of its n symbols. So if a message has 3 A's, 2 B's, and 1 C, the probability of that message is the probability of A raised to the third power times the probability of B squared times the probability of C. For a typical message, the probability is the product of the PIs for all the symbols raised to the power n times PI. As n approaches infinity, random messages are almost always typical. So the sum of these probabilities approaches 1. And since the probabilities are all the same, the sum is also equal to the total number of typical messages times this probability. So the total number of typical messages is approximately the reciprocal of that probability. Thus, the number of bits you need to point to a specific typical message with n symbols is log base 2 of this. This comes from the fact that a binary code of L bits can only distinguish between 2 to the power of L different messages. We also can't use shorter codes because those are for the shorter messages. What we just very loosely went over was a proof of this source coding theorem. This summation and this negative is called h of x, the entropy of a random symbol x. The fact that your expected code length can get as close as you want to, but not any less than n times h bits, is the source coding theorem. Entropy represents how much information you need to learn, on average, about a random variable to tell what it is. It's the expected value of the information content, I, of the outcome of a random variable x. When the base of this logarithm is 2, information is in units called bits or shannons. An outcome gives you more information when it's less probable, and no information if it was guaranteed. Our goal is to encode each symbol into h bits on average. So we should encode any symbol with information content I into I bits. And this intuitively makes sense. We want to encode more frequent symbols with fewer bits. A nice fact is that the information content of a message is equal to the sum of the information contents of its symbols conditioned on the previous symbols. So in general, anything with information content I should be encoded into I bits. Compression algorithms that try to do this are called entropy coders. Huffman is one of them, but it only achieves entropy when symbol probabilities are powers of 2, because each symbol has to be encoded with a whole number of bits. So what about that base converting algorithm I showed you earlier? For an alphabet of 10 symbols, all with probability 1/10, this does achieve entropy. We'll call the number that a message spells out x, so x is the number 16 quintillion 300 and so on. The entropy of the message is the entropy per symbol times the number of symbols, approximately log base 10 of x. But this is also approximately the number of digits in the binary representation of x, which is what we use as code. But there is a bug. If the message starts with a 0, then converting it to base 2 will mess it up. So we have to add something to the start of every message. You can either add a decimal point and treat this as a number between 0 and 1, which will lead you to arithmetic coding, or you can add another non-zero symbol and treat it as a natural number, which will bring you to asymmetric numeral systems. I'll describe arithmetic coding first. If we think of our message as a decimal sequence representing some number from 0 to 1, each digit stratifies the range into 10 subsections, and the particular digit chooses which section the number lies in. This section will be our new range, and each successive digit divides the range further. So if you associate each subdivision with a symbol, you can specify an entire message with just one number. If you have n symbols in your alphabet, then each symbol divides the current range into n subsections instead of 10. There's a problem, though. Not all numbers can be represented in finitely many bits. For example, 1/10 has an infinite binary expansion. The way you fix this is by adding a new symbol to the alphabet, the end of file or end of message. When you reach an end of file, you stop subdividing the range. So each end of file section represents one full message. Then the encoder can just output any binary number that lies within the end of file section for a particular message. To generate this number, we start out with a range that covers the interval from 0 to 1, and we subdivide it into symbols. To encode a symbol, we shrink our range around the symbol's section. Our code must be a number in this range. So if the range is entirely in one half of the full code space, we can output a bit specifying which half it's in, then renormalize our range to that half. This will help us avoid precision errors. If it's in one half of this half, we can output another bit, and we do this until the symbol range doesn't lie strictly in one half anymore. Then we subdivide the range again, and repeat. We do have a problem when the range lies in the middle, though. Because it's not strictly in one half, we can't output a bit, and subdividing it might make the section so small that we lose precision. But theoretically, our range should eventually fall into one of the halves or into an end of file. When that happens, we'll output one bit, renormalize, then output a ton of the opposite bit. So when the range lies not in an outer half, but within this middle half, we can renormalize to it, and keep track of how many times we do this. When the range finally comes to one of the halves, output a bit for that half, followed by one of the opposite bit for each time we renormalize to the middle. That's basically the whole encoding algorithm. We'll get to optimizing this for entropy in a bit. I just want to mention that in practice, you wouldn't actually work with numbers from 0 to 1, but instead with integers in a big integer range that's a power of 2. All the numbers you work with are integers in this range, and the decoder should reproduce the exact same integers that the encoder generated at each step. When we come to an end of file, we need just two more bits, plus any pending bits, to ensure our number lies within the section. Let's look at the number of bits we use to encode a message. Each bit halves our code space, this range that includes all the numbers whose binary expansion starts with this code. And we stop when the code space is within the message's range. So we stop when 1 half to the power of n, where n is the number of bits, shrinks to the size of the section. So the number of bits is negative log base 2 of that. If we want the number of bits to equal the information content of the message, we need to make the size of any end of file section equal to the probability of whatever message it's specifying. Because the probability of the message is just the product of the probabilities of its symbols, all we need to do is make the subsection size for each symbol proportional to the symbol's probability. Each symbol you choose will then multiply the size of the range by the probability. This also lets you make your probabilities adaptive. The probabilities can update themselves based on previously seen symbols. As long as both the encoder and decoder agree with the probabilities at each step, the code will work. If you want to see a full implementation of an arithmetic encoder and decoder, I've linked to a nice explanation in the description. The last thing I'll leave you with is the asymmetric numeral system. With arithmetic coding, we store data as a number between 0 and 1, but with ANS, we store it in a natural number that we'll call x. Let's first look at the decimal system again, so our symbols are the digits 0 through 9. We saw that setting x to the concatenation of the symbols in the message, plus an extra digit on the left, worked for uniform symbol probabilities. So let's break down what happens to x as you encode each symbol. X starts out with an initial value of that extra digit. Then, to encode a symbol, you multiply x by 10 and add its symbol index. So to encode a 3, multiply by 10 and add 3. Now, what we're going to do is label the natural numbers with their final digit. So single-digit numbers are labeled themselves, 15 is labeled 5, and 100 is labeled 0. Then you can also represent encoding a symbol as looking at the set of numbers labeled with that symbol and counting x plus 1 of them. So if x is currently 13, which means we've already encoded a 3, and we want to encode the symbol 4, which should make x 134, we look at all the numbers labeled 4 and count 14 of them. And we set x to 134. This works because each number labeled 4 is 10 numbers away from the last, so counting by x plus 1 just multiplies x by 10 with an offset of 4. We'll call this process c, so c of x, 4 is the x plus 1th number in the set of all numbers labeled 4. Now we just encode by repeatedly setting x to c of x, symbol. The reason we do it this roundabout way is because to incorporate probability, we'll rearrange these labels, so they won't correspond to multiplication and addition anymore, but some analogous operation in an asymmetric numeral system. So if we have n symbols, then each natural number will be labeled one of the n symbols instead of one of 10 digits. The encoding will still be the same, we're still just finding the x plus 1th number labeled with a symbol. Their labelings will just be asymmetric. To generate this labeling, let's think about approximately how big c of x, a should get for some symbol a. The binary representation of x is what we'll use as a code, so if we encode n symbols, then the length of x in binary should be about the sum of the information content of the first n symbols. If we exponentiate with a base of 2, we find that x should be approximately equal to the product of the reciprocals of the probabilities of the symbols. So when we encode a new symbol a, then c of x, a should be around x divided by the probability of a. Back to our labeling of the naturals, we saw that c of x, 4 multiplies x by the space between each number labeled 4 and adds something. So if we instead want to divide x by the probability, the space between each number labeled with a symbol should be approximately the reciprocal of the probability of that symbol. The effect of this is that the density of the natural numbers labeled with a symbol corresponds to the probability of that symbol. Unfortunately, it is not easy to label the naturals in such a way that all symbols are spaced out appropriately, so you instead just define a labeling for some range n using some heuristic, and then repeat that labeling across every block of n naturals. The decoder works in reverse, so the last symbol you encoded will be the first symbol you decode, which means we do have to encode our message backwards. The decoded symbol is just whatever symbol the number at x is labeled as, and to reproduce the previous x, remember that this x got here by just counting this symbol, previous x plus 1, times. So the previous x is the number of naturals labeled a that are less than x. We'll call this operation d, so d of x is the previous x. Then to decode, you extract a symbol, set x to d of x, and repeat until x reaches its initial state. Now in practice, during encoding, when x gets too big, we have to renormalize it down, and output some bits to encode any lost information. The way we do it is by predicting where c of x will end up before encoding the symbol. If it's above some threshold t, we'll renormalize by looking at the binary representation of the current x and popping off the last bit to put in the bitstream. What this does to x is it divides it by 2 and rounds down. We keep doing this until our predicted c of normalized x goes below t. Once it does, we set our next x to c of normalized x, y to encode our symbol. This way, x will always be less than t. Now, the decoder has to know when this bit chopping has happened so it can scale back up. We know that the encoder always keeps x less than t, so if any bit chopping happened to x, normalized x must be less than t divided by 2. So if the decoder sets x to d of x, and it comes to a number less than t over 2, the decoder can multiply by 2 and take a bit from the bitstream, and repeat this until it reaches t over 2, in which case it will have reproduced the original, unnormalized x. Now for this to work, you have to set t to 2n, twice the size of a labeling block. Otherwise, the decoder might try to scale up an x that just happened to fall under t over 2. Then during encoding, you initialize x to a number less than n, such that c of x is greater than or equal to n. This way, x will always lie within the range n to 2n-1. Because we initialized with a value less than n, the decoder knows to stop when x comes below n, but there are no more bits in the bitstream to renormalize with. You can store some data with this initial value. It'll be the last thing the decoder reproduces. The final, brilliant thing about ANS is that this entire algorithm can be condensed into a set of tables. Everything, encoding, renormalization, decoding, is done with just a couple references to these tables, which makes tabled ANS super fast, with compression rates comparable, depending on your labeling, to arithmetic coding, which is slow. I've linked to my Python implementation in the description if you want to see details. The only problem is that you can't make the probabilities context adaptive like in arithmetic coding. But there are other versions, range ANS and binary ANS, that use the same ideas to make super fast adaptive algorithms. If you've heard of JPEG XL, a pretty incredible open file format aiming to permanently replace JPEG, that uses range ANS, the public domain algorithm that Microsoft was later granted a patent for in 2022. The patent office is just unequipped to analyze complex software patents. Even though it's based on perhaps the simplest encoding algorithm, just treating the message as one big number, ANS is pretty convoluted. So I hope this video has made it at least a little more accessible.